stand and lift up our hands. For the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. And together we sing, oh yes, Lord God Almighty.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's so good to have you here, and I'm glad that you could join us live and in person for our service. Also want to say hello to those who will be watching online as well. Just a few announcements for you. We are holding Church with a Difference, and that will be taking place in 2 weeks on Sunday, September 20th, 5 o'clock, and we're hoping to have a corn roast and some burgers and a brief message as well. And you don't have to sign up for that. It's an outdoor event. There will be some COVID protocols in place. Eric has been working closely with the health unit on making sure that everything is as safe as possible for us to do this event. If you would like to volunteer and help out, please speak to Eric about that. Young adults, we have an event this coming Friday, September 11th, 6 o'clock. We will meet at the Burford Park. They have a sand volleyball court there. And so we're going to be playing some volleyball. And I took a look at the net yesterday. You do not have to be very tall to be successful with this particular net, but we're looking forward to a good time. And then following, we'll come back to our house and look forward to a time of fellowship. Our next outdoor prayer meeting will take place on Wednesday, September 16th at 6:30. We do that in the parking lot. Please bring a chair, bring a Bible. We've had a handful of these now, and they've gone well. So I'd encourage you to come and be a part of that. And just a final note on the offering. If you do want to give at the end of the service, we do have offering boxes available. Just when you leave, have it ready to drop in. Of course, you can also give by mailing it to the church, dropping it off at the church, or by e-transfer. Our other ways of giving as well. Let's take a moment to pray together, and then we're going to do video worship again. The first song will be a new one to us. The second one you will know very well, but just a chance for us to worship the Lord, though quietly, through worship. Let's sing together. Let's pray together. Don't sing. Don't do that. Let's pray together, shall we? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we have to come to gather in your name, to be here, to worship you, to praise you, to bring our prayer before you, and Lord, to look into your word. What a wonderful gift you have given us in your word. I pray, Lord, that we will be students of it. I pray that we will desire to know it as well as we can, so that we can apply what you have told us to our lives, that we may live as you have called us to live. Be with us now as we worship you together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. I am going to be leading us in congregational prayer this morning. And just a few things that we're going to be praying for this morning. This time of year being Labor Day weekend, this is the time of year when ordinarily there's a big transition as the teachers and the kids go back to school, the college and university students are returning again. This year obviously is a little different, and we're seeing that reflected in our own household. And I think we're probably typical that the rush to physically go back to school isn't what it would normally be at this time of year. So that's a downside for the students who would like to be back and back physically in school. But there is an upshot in that many more of our young adults are going to be with us over the coming months until things fully get back to normal. So there is some blessing in that as well. So we'll be praying for the students and the teachers returning to school. I'm sure you're all aware of the passing of Caroline Solomon, and I think that what you may be less aware of is some of you I guess have asked about funeral and so on. There was a private funeral that took place last week. So in case you're wondering, it was a private thing that took place last week. But we'll be praying for the family and so on during our prayer this morning. We want to be thinking of our place in the world as a church and the larger Christian church within the world in these strange times. So we'll be praying for that. And we'll also be praying for our missionary couple of the month, the Burwells, Randy and Rachel Burwell in Mongolia. Okay, so at this time, please bow with me for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your gift to us, the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you have loved us enough to send your Son as Savior for us to atone for our sin. And Lord, the fact that we can have that shared faith, and that we can be a church together that fellowships together under the Lordship of Christ, giving praise and honor and glory to him, even in these strange times, Lord. So we thank you for the blessings that you have granted us as a church. And Father, we pray for the students and the teachers, Lord, as they are returning to school in the coming week. Some will be going back physically, others will just be online. But regardless, Lord, we pray for their safety. We pray that you would grant them safety and security from this disease. We pray, Lord, for them to be able to adapt to different conditions for both the teachers and the students. Lord, may the learning progress regardless, Lord, of the changed circumstances. So, Father, we pray for wisdom, making wise decisions. We pray for patience, Lord. We pray for our students to be able to learn and our teachers to be able to teach, Lord, and to do so safely. Father, we pray for the family of Caroline Solomon. We grieve that at her loss, Lord, but know that she is with you in glory. And so, Father, we praise you for that blessing. And Father, we pray for comfort during this time of grieving for her family. We also pray, Lord, for our church. We pray for Shenstone Baptist. We praise you and thank you, Lord, that you've enabled us to gather, to reopen, and to carry on. And we pray for our members, Lord, who call Shenstone your home, whether they be here physically or at home online. We pray, Lord, that they would be strengthened in you. We pray they would be encouraged in you. We pray that the words that of your scripture that we read today and study in the book of Mark may be an encouragement to them. And Father, we pray that you would bless our church moving forward, and be able to, that you would bring us back together to be able to meet again physically and fully, Lord, that this pandemic that's happening would be a momentary thing that would pass, and that we could get back to normal again. And Lord, that we would not just get back to normal, but we would be revived and renewed in our in our mission, in our ministry, Lord, and powered by your Holy Spirit, we pray. And Lord, in a larger sense, we pray that for the Christian church worldwide, Lord, that had its challenges before COVID, and certainly will have its challenges after. But Father, you are sovereign, and you are Lord of the Christian church worldwide, and we pray for renewal to happen. We pray that your Holy Spirit would be moving in the hearts and minds of men and women, both who know you, Lord, and those who don't know you, and Lord, that you would be leading unsaved people to come to you in salvation, to come to the foot of the cross in salvation, and Lord, that you would be leading saved people to be experiencing sanctification, to becoming more Christ-like, to becoming more in practice what they are in profession, Lord. And I pray that that would be true both here in our midst, Lord, and that would be true larger in the Christian church worldwide. And on that note, Lord, we pray for the Burwell family in Mongolia and the work that they do there. We pray, Lord, that they would be able to continue their work unabated. We pray, Lord, for the country of Mongolia, a vast land with a population that mostly doesn't know you. So there is a great need for your gospel message there, Lord. And we pray that you would enable the Burwell family to be effective in their ministry and that they could continue unabated, we pray. And Lord, now as we turn to your word, we thank you that we can do so freely. We thank you for the words that you've given us in the Gospel of Mark, Lord, and in the rest of your scripture, words that are directly from you, Lord. We thank you that you have given us minds that can read and think and understand. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit would lend understanding to us this morning, that the words on the page would be open to us, and Lord, that our hearts and minds would be aligned with yours as a result of the study of your words. We pray for Pastor Andrew this morning as he delivers it. May you give us ears to hear and eyes to see and minds to think and hearts to obey. We pray all these things in the name of Christ. Amen.
That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There was also other boats with him. A furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." This is the word of the Lord. Thank you. You may be seated. spectacular events that take place in the life of Christ. We can also read about them in Matthew 8 and 9, as well as in Luke chapter 8. The details of these events that we are about to read lead to the conclusion that it was an eyewitness account, that there was someone actually there who saw all of these things take place. And based on what the fathers of the church have written, we believe that Mark was writing Peter's experiences of the life of Christ. So Peter is the one who would have all of these details that he could share and show us these eyewitness accounts. We look at each one of these accounts and we see that there is a great need in each one of them, that all of the individuals that Jesus encounters are incapable of overcoming the obstacles that they face on their own, and that each situation was extremely grim. And here we have evidence of the kingdom of God at work. And kind of the one question that we want to focus on as we go through these four events in the life of Christ is, who is this? Remember that when Mark writes, he is writing so that we will respond to who Jesus is. And so when he includes these questions, he's getting not only those whom Jesus encountered in his day to answer that question, but he wants his readers to try and answer that question again. Who is this? And this follows on the heels of other questions that we have already encountered in the Gospel of Mark. When Jesus was that later. Jesus is the one who rebukes the storm and makes it calm. Jesus is the one who rebukes the storm and makes it calm. So just proceeding on the teaching of, or after teaching the parables that Jesus has taught, it is now evening and Jesus says to his disciples, let's go to the other side. Jesus is just looking for a bit of a break. And so he says to the disciples, let's go. And they take him in the boats and they go across. And as they are crossing to the other side, there is this storm that suddenly arises. Now, this is not uncommon on the Sea of Galilee. These storms can happen very quickly and they can be very severe. And the disciples don't know what to do. It says in verse 37, a furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus is in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, teacher, don't you care if we drown? The disciples were unable to respond to a crisis with confidence in God or in Jesus, which is the mark of the true disciple. I found those words very convicting because I know that there have been times in my own life where you're just going through something that is challenging and it's hard and it's difficult, and maybe you don't quite put it the same way, teacher, don't you care if we drown? But maybe we ask the question, Jesus, do you care at all? Jesus, are you really interested in me in any way? I'm going through this and I feel alone and I don't think you're doing anything, and I know you could do something and I wish you would do something, but I don't see anything happening, and it's as if you do not care. And that impacts our faith. I was reading J.C. Ryle last night, and one of the comments he made was that the disciples of Christ are sent into the storm. That we will have hardships in life, that we will have challenges, there will be difficulties, and they are there to test and to refine our faith. And that's why Jesus asked the questions, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? If you haven't noticed by now, throughout the Gospel of Mark until the resurrection, the disciples are a little obtuse. They're a little slow to really grasp who Jesus is. They have some moments of clarity, but full understanding doesn't come until later. And then after this incredible miracle, now they're terrified again. It's interesting, the Greek there is phobos megas. Phobos megas. Now, you do not have to be a Greek scholar to know that phobos means fear, phobia, and megas means a lot, right? We're talking about mega fear that these disciples are experiencing, no longer because of the storm, but because of what Jesus was able to do. Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. Now, the question is to get us to consider the nature and identity of Jesus who has been introduced to us. It's to get us to think long and hard about who is this Jesus and what is he capable of? What is he all about? Who is this? He is the one who rebukes the storm and makes it calm. Secondly, Jesus is the one who restores the demon-possessed. Jesus is the one who restores the demon-possessed. Now, this account takes place in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We can read about it in each one of those Gospels, but Mark is the one who gives us the most detail of any of these, of any of the Gospels. And notice how it describes that man. So they get across the lake after the storm. And as they get across the lake, it says, when Jesus gets out of the boat, a man with an evil spirit came from the tombs to meet him. The man lived in the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore the chains apart and broke the irons on his feet. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and in the hills, he would cry out and cut himself with stones. This is a picture of a man who is in total bondage. Here is a man who has lost complete control over himself, that this possession that he faces has taken over his whole body, his actions, even his name, we find out later, and his speech, because as Jesus speaks to this individual, it is the demon who is responding, not this man. It is a man who is in total bondage. He was a man who is now an outcast because he was uncontrollable, living among the tombs. Death just reeks around this man. I love that particular passage, or that verse, where it says, no one was strong enough to subdue him. In verse 5, no one was strong enough to subdue him. Well, there should be echoes that come to our mind because Jesus told a story in chapter 3 and verse 27 where he talks about going in and tying up the strong man and binding him so that he could rob his house, or he could, in this case, set the captives free. Jesus is the one who is strong enough to help this man. Nobody else could do it. This man was completely lost. He was helpless and he was hopeless. When he sees just Jesus from a distance, he ran and he falls on his knees in front of him. And notice, as this man possessed by this demon shouts at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" Who is this? Just answered the question, haven't they? Jesus, the Son of the Most High God. They recognize Jesus, and that's one of the features of the Gospel of Mark, that evil spirits always recognize Jesus first. They know exactly who he is. They know exactly what he is capable of. And they know that they do not have the power to overcome him. And we see that there is this conflict. Jesus is superior to these evil spirits. And he is also hostile to them. Notice what they say. They say, "Don't torture me. Don't torture me." In the Gospel of Luke, they said, "Have you come to send us into the abyss?" Knowing that that will be their destiny at the end of time. And Jesus says to him, "What is your name?" "My name is Legion," he replied, "for we are many." And he begged Jesus again and again not to send them out of the area. So not only is this man that we have read about is completely lost, we find that it's not just one particular evil spirit that he has to deal with, but a whole host of evil spirits that he has to deal with. So Jesus gives permission to these spirits, these evil spirits. They ask, "Can we go among the pigs? Allow us to go into them." And he gives them permission, and the evil spirits came out and went into the pigs. The herd, about 2,000 in number, rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. There's a couple things I think that we need to point out here. First of all, 2,000 evil spirits are no match for the authority and the power of Jesus Christ. No evil spirit, Satan himself, is never strong enough to overcome Jesus. Secondly, there's this question about the pigs. Well, why would he allow the pigs? Well, just like in the healing of the paralytic man, when Jesus says, "Get up, take up your mat, and go home," in order for Jesus to show his authority to forgive sins, we have to see a visible demonstration of the power that Jesus has. And so when these pigs are gone, we see that there is this visible demonstration of the power that Jesus shows, that the miracle has actually happened, and that Jesus has a victory over an army of demons. And notice how complete this victory is. Verse 15, when they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons sitting there, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. There is now no doubt of the reality of the scale of the deliverance that has been effected. Everyone who lived in the area of the Decapolis would know who this man was and what he was like, and they would stay clear of him, no doubt. But they would be aware of who he was, and now he is completely transformed. He is no longer naked. He is dressed. He is no longer wandering around the tombs. He is sitting there. He is no longer crying out and cutting himself. He is in his right mind. And the people who live in that area have no idea what to do with that. They couldn't help this man, and now that this man has been helped, they look at Jesus and they are afraid of him. So much so. They don't sit in awe of the miracle that has just happened and the victory that has just been granted. Instead, they ask Jesus to leave. And so he does. He gets back in the boat. And as he's getting back in the boat, this man comes to Jesus and he says, "Let me come with you." And Jesus does not let him come. But he says, "Go home to your family and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." So the man went away and began to tell in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and all the people were amazed. Well, the region of the Decapolis are 10 Greek cities in that part of Israel. So now what's happening is that Jesus has a witness that he is sent to the Greek-speaking people in the Decapolis. So now they are hearing about this Messiah. They are hearing about this one. And what kind of testimony would that be? Would you go somewhere where there is a testimony of a man who had been possessed by 2,000 demons and who is now in his right mind and dressed and now giving glory to Jesus for all that he had done? How many of you would want to go to that testimony? I certainly would want to be there and hear about it. One other thought too. I guess two other thoughts. Jesus knows where this man can best be used in ministry. Jesus knows where this man can best be used in ministry. And sometimes we have our own thought of how we want Jesus to use us in ministry, whatever role that may take. But Jesus has a plan. And Jesus' plan for this man was to send him back to his home to share what Jesus had done for him. And that's a role that we have, to share with others what Jesus has done for us. Interesting, John Calvin speaking on this particular topic says this: though we are not tortured by the devil, I wonder, yet he holds us as his slaves till the Son of God delivers us from his tyranny. Naked, torn, and disfigured, we wander about till he restores us to soundness of mind because of the transformation that takes place with what Jesus does for each and every one of us. And when that transformation takes place, we are told not to keep it to ourselves. We are told to share it with others. The third point today, Jesus is the one who relieves suffering. Jesus is the one who relieves suffering. And I hope that you are capturing some of the intensity that takes place in every single one of these events. So Jesus has calmed a storm. Jesus has just won a major victory for a man who is possessed by 2,000 demons. And when Jesus again has crossed over in the boat to the other side of a lake, there's a large crowd already waiting there. And there is a synagogue ruler. His name is Jairus. And he comes up to Jesus and he falls at his feet and he pleads earnestly with him because his daughter's dying. And he asks Jesus to come and put his hands on her so that she will be healed and live. And Jesus has already saved the disciples from drowning in a storm. He's already saved a man who is cutting himself and not in his right mind. And now a man whose daughter is dying, who is ill, he has no control over it. As a father, there is nothing he can do as he watches his little girl suffer. So he comes to Jesus. He's an important man in the town. He's one of the synagogue rulers. He wants Jesus to come and make a difference in the life of his daughter. While Jesus goes with this man, so Jesus is willing, please note that, Jesus is willing, but while Jesus is going, there is another woman who is also in a position in life where she cannot help herself. She's been bleeding for 12 years. She suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors. She had spent all she has. And yet, instead of getting better, the text tells us she grows worse. You can see here in the picture, here's the woman down here just touching the back of Jesus as he is walking through the crowd of people. All kinds of people are around him. And this woman just, in the imagery we're given, just crawls up behind Jesus and she thinks, if I can just touch his coat, if I can just touch his coat, I don't even have to bother him, I don't have to interrupt him, if I can just touch his coat, I can be healed. So that's what she does. Immediately, the bleeding stopped. She felt it in her body. She knew she was well, and she was freed from her suffering. It's a miracle that has taken place. And I love this. In the very next verse, at once, Verse 30, at once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and he asked, "Who touched my clothes?" And the disciples look at Jesus and they're like, "Jesus, how can we possibly know who touched you? Look at all these people. We can barely walk. There's so many people. They're all around you and they're jostling. All kinds of people have touched you." Jesus is very concerned about the individual. And Jesus keeps looking around to see who had done it. And then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. She shared her story with Jesus and what he had done for her. Jesus was her only and last hope. Notice these tender, tender words Jesus speaks. "Daughter." This is the only time in the Gospels where Jesus refers to a woman as daughter. "Your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. What a remarkable thing. That word "healed" could also be translated "saved." I think that there's more than just a physical saving in mind here, but there's a theological element, just like the paralytic whose sins had been forgiven. I think there's a theological aspect that she is now able to go in peace, not just free of her illness and her suffering, not just free of the anxiety that she has faced, but she is now brought into right relationship with God. And as a result of this healing that she has experienced and now is in a right relationship with God, she's now free and able to go back into society. Because of the bleeding that she had endured for many years, she would be an outcast. She would be unclean. She would not be able to be involved in the life of the community. Because if she interacted with any of them, then they also would be unclean. And so Jesus has restored this woman to health, to her community, and into a right relationship with God. He's done all of that. Well, in the midst of Jesus doing this wonderful work, while he was on his way to save this little girl, we find out that the little girl dies. The little girl dies. Well, Jesus was still speaking, so he had just told this woman to go in peace, freed from her suffering. Some men came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. "Your daughter is dead. Why bother the teacher anymore?" Jesus can calm a storm. Jesus can cast out 2,000 demons. Jesus can heal this woman of her sickness. But death is the end. That's it. When you die, there's no coming back from that. I love what it says in the NIV. Verse 36. "Ignoring what they said." Ignoring what they said, Jesus told the synagogue ruler, "Don't be afraid, just believe." Do not fear. Just believe. This is not the end. So Jesus goes into this room. He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Goes in, and people are crying and they are wailing loudly. They're professional mourners that are common in these types of funeral in that day. And Jesus says, "Why is this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep." And they laughed at him. Laugh at him. "Jesus, you're saying ridiculous things. It's clear the girl is dead. There's no coming back from that. So Jesus puts them all out. He takes the child's father and mother, the three disciples, Peter, James, and John, and they go in. He takes this girl who is dead by the hand, and he says to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." Verse 42, wastes no time. Immediately the girl stood up, walked around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. Jesus gives strict orders to tell them, because he does not want a misunderstanding about the nature of his messianic mission, as we have seen throughout the Gospel of Mark. He tells them to give her something to eat. Like its younger brother, sickness, death is an enemy, but it must yield to the powers of the messianic kingdom present in Jesus. In the presence of Christ, death becomes a sleeping. Until the parousia, the second coming, its sting remains, but its ultimate threat is broken. If we believe, we need not live in dread. Fear not. Jesus is the one who raises the dead. Our fourth point, Jesus is the one who raises the dead. So who is this? Who is this? In each case, the individual in need came to Jesus. Please note that. The disciples came to Jesus when the boat was going to be swamped. The demoniac came to Jesus. Jairus, the father of this little girl, came to Jesus. This woman came to Jesus. All of them came to Jesus because they knew that he was the one who could make the difference. Men, women, young and old can come to Jesus. Something struck me as we went through these passages, and especially in the three events with the man possessed by demons and the woman who was bleeding and the father who came to ask that Jesus would come and heal her little girl. Did you notice two things? All of them fell on their knees before Jesus. Did you note that? All of them fell on their knees before Jesus. And there is an element of fear in every single episode. Every single episode, there is an element of fear. And I think what this speaks to is an attitude of heart. Because we can come and fall in our knees before Jesus in complete and total fear of his awesome power, which is what the demons did that were in that man. They knew what Jesus was capable of. And they had to fall on their knees before him. But I think there's another element. That we can come before Jesus in humility. That we can come to Jesus on our knees and in fear. And not a fear that is trembling in the sense of we're not sure what's going to happen. But in awe and respect of the authority and the power that Jesus has. We can fall on our knees in worship. And please note this in Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 and 11, that ultimately, everyone is going to fall on their knees before Christ. The question is, with what attitude will we do it? Sorry, it's in Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 to 11, says, "Therefore God exalted him to the highest place." This is after Jesus has been risen from the dead after being obedient to death on a cross. "And God gives him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, and in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." At some point, we will all bow. And at some point, we will all confess Jesus as Lord. The question is, what is the attitude of our heart when we do so? It is one of humility, one that has come to him in repentance and asked forgiveness and acknowledges him as Lord and Savior. Now the question that I would ask is, what can't Jesus do? What can't Jesus do? Nature has answered the command of Jesus. Evil spirits have answered the command of Jesus. A woman with an incurable disease who has suffered greatly. The disease answers the command of Jesus. And even death answers the command of Jesus. Jesus makes the unclean clean. Ritual uncleanness brought about by the graves that the man possessed lived amongst. The woman who was bleeding, the dead girl, all signs of uncleanness. And yet Jesus restores them all. Jesus restores every single one of them. So how do we answer that question? Who is this? Who is Jesus? Do we come to him with the right attitude of heart, falling on our knees in reverence and awe? This Jesus is the Son of the Most High God. And he comes with a message that we have heard at the beginning of the gospel. Repent and believe the good news. The kingdom is present. Jesus has brought it. And there's nothing that can oppose him. There is nothing greater than him. Everything falls under his authority, and we have seen that today in these four vignettes of the life of Christ. Who is this Jesus, the Son of the Most High God, through whom we can be saved? Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you in awe of your Son. Lord, I confess that at times I'm very much like the disciples, asking the question, do you really care? Don't you see the trouble that I'm in? Don't you see what I'm facing? Don't you see the challenges of life that are before me? And I allow my fear to overwhelm my faith. Lord, help us not to be like that. Help us to have our confidence and our trust in you, that when we face these situations, that we can come to you, knowing that you are there, knowing that you can and will help. And though we face these situations for a period of time, we know that in the end, you are the one who will lead us out. Lord, for those who may be trapped by the spiritual forces of Satan, Lord, help us not to downplay the reality of the work of the enemy in our world. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy, and he is doing a good job of that in our world. And help us to recognize that Jesus is the one who overcomes, that Jesus is the one who can restore any who are facing this kind of oppression or possession. Lord, we thank you for how you care for individuals. Whether it's this woman who is bleeding, you so compassionately, with great love and care, refer to as daughter. Whether it's this little girl, 12 years old, who died, and yet you go on the journey to her house to raise her from the dead. Lord, I thank you for the care of individuals that you show. You cared for the disciples. You cared for this man possessed by evil spirits, for this family, Jairus' family, for this woman. Lord, we can never miss those tender moments in Scripture. Let us finally answer that question, who is Jesus? That Jesus is the Son of the Most High God, that Jesus is Lord and Savior. That Jesus is, as we read in Revelation, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He was on a mission to rescue each and every one of us. And Lord, if we have received that saving grace, that we would go and tell others what the Lord has done for us, that they too may experience that saving grace. We pray all these things in your Son's most holy and precious name. Amen. Well, I do have a closing song. It will be a new one, but I hope that you like it.
There is none.
close in prayer. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, you are our treasure and you are the one who satisfies our soul. There is grace for the guilty. There is help for the needy. And we have seen that in this passage before us this morning. Lord, I pray that as we go out from here, we will just reflect on the treasure that you are. And the things that you have done and the things that you continue to do and the things that you will do. We do not have to be afraid. But we know that we can trust you completely, that we can count on you as we journey through this life. And know that there is a day that will come. As we have heard already, there's a day that will come when our faith will be sight. And we long for that day. The world is made right. When sin is no more, when sickness is no more, when death is no more, and we've had a glimpse of that again in the passage before us. So Lord, I pray that you will just burden us for those who are suffering, for those who are unforgiven, for those who are not saved. That we will share with them the treasure of Christ, that their souls may be satisfied as well. May we go out from here, Lord, with your blessing and with a boldness and a fearlessness to go and tell what the Lord has done for us. We pray these things in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. All right, so.